The table of showbread in the tabernacle was located just inside the holy place on the right side. It is also known as the table of faces or the table of presence. It's symbolically in the tabernacle, it was the place where you quote unquote met God face to face. And I've always found that to be of great interest. And so today we're going to talk about bread, literally and symbolically. And our goal is to better understand about setting an atmosphere for miracles. So let's start by turning to Mark 6 and verse 30. And what has happened? John the Baptist has been beheaded. Verse 30 simply says, "And the apostles gathered themselves together unto Jesus and told him all the things, both what they had done and what they had taught." And starting right there, we're going to start to look at our really core lesson. Verse 31 says, "And he said unto them, Come ye yourselves apart unto a desert place and rest a while, for there were many coming and going, and they had no leisure much as to eat." What that really says is that they were busy. In fact, they were so busy, they hadn't had time to eat. Now, I don't know how many of you have ever been in that mode where you're just constantly on the go, busy, busy, busy. There's the pressures of things going on, and you literally don't have time to stop and eat. But that's what was going on. They were under that kind of pressure. So, you know, the first thing I want us to think about is that we don't have an exclusive on too busy. They had it here in biblical times, and they were busy in ministry. So you may say, well, I'm so busy in ministry that I'm going crazy. And yet what verse 31 tells us is that Jesus said to them, come away into a desert place and rest a while. And there's a time when we need to rest a while. We need to recharge the batteries. And I'm not talking about, well, I need to step away from my ministry, or I need to take a 4-month vacation, or I'm not talking about that. But we need to have a time and a place where we can recharge, where we can rest. And one of the things that is very difficult for ministers to do sometimes is get fed themselves, because they're so busy worrying about what they're going to minister. And I'm a big believer in letting other people teach and preach and speak into my life, because I will burn out if I only go based on what I am studying for ministry. So he's telling them, hey, you need to recharge a little bit. You need to rest here a little bit, because it says, for there were many coming and going. So there's the hustle and bustle and all the things going on. And they had no leisure. They had no pause. They had no relaxation to even eat. Okay? And so we need to make sure that we spend time in rest. And the best way to rest is what's found in Psalms 23, when it says, he maketh me lie down. All right? In other words, he says, take a break. Rest a little bit. We need to spend some time in prayer, not seeking God for a specific thing, but just communing with God, letting his presence recharge us. And many of us don't even know how to start to do that. Just get in prayer and just let God recharge you. But that's the process. And you can literally start that simply. God, I'm just here to be with you. Just be in your presence and soak in your presence and be recharged, and he will be faithful in those things. It says, basically, verse 31 tells us, and I wrote this down somewhat tongue-in-cheek, but the needs are many and the rests are few. There's always something that needs to be done. There's always somebody that needs to be ministered to. There's always a need, and I don't want you to disregard the needs, but I want you to understand that there needs to be a time where you rest and recharge so that you have something to give. All right, so verse 32 says, and they departed into a desert place by ship privately. So they're doing what they're supposed to do. And then it's always like this. And the people saw them departing, and many knew him, and ran afoot thither out all the cities, and out went them and came together unto him. In other words, the people saw them going and went, up, oh, they're leaving. We got to go catch them. We got to go be with them. So they chased them down. And verse 34 says, and Jesus, when he came out, saw much people and was moved with compassion toward them because they were as sheep not having a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. Okay. He began to teach them many things. Why? Because he was moved with compassion. Why? Because he saw them as not having leadership over them. This ties exactly to what I just said. There's always those in need. But it also is important to understand that miracles happen. We're talking about setting an atmosphere for miracles. Miracles happen when there is a compassion for the need. And Jesus has moved, and oftentimes talks about him being moved with compassion. Sometimes we have a different view on this, and we're going to look at it in just a second. And we don't have the Lord's compassion for the situation, and we also don't see the miracle. But when we do have the Lord's compassion, then we see the miracle come forth. So compassion for the need is an important aspect that we need to examine here. Verse 35. And when the day was now far spent, his disciples came unto him and said, this is a desert place, and now the time is far past. Send them away that they may go into the country round about and into the villages and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat. Now, send them away. That's logical, right? It's not even really far removed from his statement, you need to get away. They're saying, okay, we tried that. They followed us. So now you need to send them off so they can get fed. That seems logical. That's man's logic. That's how we reason things out. But it wasn't what the Lord had in mind. So let's take a look at a little different perspective. Verse 37, he answered and said unto them, give ye them to eat. You give them to eat. Hey, we're out here in the middle of nowhere. They haven't had anything to eat. Let's send them away. And he says, why don't you give them something to eat? And they said unto him, shall we go and buy 200 penny worth of bread and give them to eat? What, you want us to go spend all this money and buy bread and bring it to them so they can eat? I mean, is that what you're asking us to do, is just go spend a bunch of money and... You know, the implication there is that we don't have, right? That's kind of the implication. And now we'll start kind of dialing down on things. See, they said, send him away. We were supposed to be getting a break here. Send him away. And Jesus' perspective is, no, you give to them. You know, where our mind goes, where, you know, when we see the situation, where does our mind go? Right. I said earlier, Jesus was moved with compassion, felt like they were shepherdless, and started teaching them. Then they had a need. The disciples said, hey, just send them away. And Jesus said, no, you give to them. It's where my mind goes in the process. When I see the problem, where does my mind go? Does it go where the shepherd's mind goes, or is it all focused in a different direction? I can't be bothered. Or I shouldn't be bothered. Now, for those of you who missed Lauren's message, go and learn, we're going to step right on the fringes of that, and you need to seek that message out and hear it, because it was a really good message. And so verse 38 says, he saith unto them, how many loaves have ye? Go and see. Go and see. Go means look into. Be open. Bring. Okay? And see, says, with eyes wide open, it's something remarkable. Experience. So Jesus says to them, so how many loaves do you have? Go look into it. Be open. Have your eyes wide open and be looking for something remarkable. And when they knew, they said, 5 and 2 fishes. So I want you to see, he tells them to give, and then he tells them to make an assessment of what they have to give and be prepared for something remarkable, to be open to something remarkable to happen, to be ready to base this on an experience. See, we talk about an atmosphere for miracles. Well, he's setting an atmosphere for a miracle right here, right now. And he's giving them the opportunity to participate in that miracle. Go. Look. Be open to what's going to happen. Be prepared for something remarkable. And they come back and go, yeah, we have 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Sounds pretty logical, but not too remarkable. And he commanded them to make them all sit down by companies upon the green grass. And they sat down in ranks by hundreds and by fifties. And when he had taken the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to his disciples to set before them, and the 2 fishes divided among them all. So I want you to look at this. He blessed the bread. Bless the loaves. And it says he had them set the bread before them. And when we look at this and its meaning in the Greek, it's set the food before them, or set the truth before them, or set the deposit into their life. Make the deposit. That's what it's talking about. So he says, go make the deposit into their life. Deposit truth. Go ahead and give them the food. And break the fishes. Divide it up. And it says, and they did all eat and were filled. And this word filled is the idea of filled to abundance. See, there's something that's happening this is a type, if you will, of the work of the cross. But the bread, the truth, Jesus said, I am the truth, the way, the truth, the life, is deposited before them, and they are filled to abundance, filled to overflowing. All their needs are met. This idea of bread here is this exact same idea that we have with the table of showbread. The table of showbread is where we come and we meet him face to face. It is literally a foretelling of Christ being the bread that was broken. It is literally foretelling his work on the cross. It is literally foretelling what we go through when we do communion, the breaking of the bread and all of that. He is the bread of life. It is that we can't live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And Jesus is the incarnation of those very words. He is the word. He is the truth. He is the bread. It's this picture that I want you to see, that he is supplying everything that is needed. The deposit of truth into your life is everything you need to fill you to abundance, to take care of whatever your situation is. In this desert place, the disciples want to send them away. They're a problem. Jesus wants to fill them to overflowing, to fill them to abundance by depositing truth into their life, by giving them the literally the bread of life. That's what's going on in this situation. And they didn't see it. Now, I'm going to read for a minute here. Verse 42, and they did all eat and were filled. Verse 43, and they took up 12 baskets full of the fragments of the fishes and of the fishes. Okay, 12 baskets of bread and fragments of the fishes is what they took up. And they that did eat of the loaves were about 5,000 men. And straightway he constrained his disciples to get into the ship and to go to the other side before unto Bethsaida, where while he sent away the people. So he said, go get in the ship and push off. I'm going to go send the people away. By the way, the place he was sending them to is the house of fish. I mean, its meaning is the house of fishing or the house of fish, okay? And so he sends the people away. Filled. Needs met. It says, and when he had sent them away, he departed unto the mountains to pray. He departed to the mountain to pray, but it's also the idea of he departed to the mountain to worship. When God moves, when the Spirit of God does things, when miracles happen, our response should be to honor God, to praise God, to thank God, to pray to God. Not asking, but thanking. Prayer is so important to the atmosphere for miracles. I have never yet met anyone that God uses to move in the miraculous that does not have a prayer life that's pretty extensive. You spend time with God in prayer. That is key. It says, verse 47, and when even was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and he alone on the land. And when he saw them toiling and rowing, for the wind was contrary unto them, and about the fourth watch of the night, he cometh unto them, walking upon the sea, and he would have passed by them. But when they saw him walking upon the sea, they supposed it had been a spirit and cried out. For they all saw him and were troubled. And immediately he talked with them and said unto them, be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. Would have walked right on by, but they saw him, freaked out. He said, don't panic. It's existence. I exist. Here I am. You can relax. Don't be afraid. And verse 51 says, and he went up unto them into the ship, and the wind ceased. And they were sore amazed in themselves beyond measure and wondered. So, here they are. I wonder when he sent them off in the ship and said, I'll stay here and send the people away, if they were like, well, how is he getting there? Right? I wonder. I don't know. But anyway, so there they are. They're working. The wind's blowing in against them and all this stuff. And then here he comes walking along on the water, and he would have walked on by. They freak out. He tells them, don't. Calm down. And he goes up into the ship with them, and the wind stops. That in itself, wow, really? That's pretty amazing. And it says they were so amazed in themselves beyond measure and wondered. They were like, wow, I don't know what to even think. In fact, I'm looking inwardly at myself, and I can't explain this. This is beyond my explanation of what's going on, which sounds like a miracle again, right? And then verse 52, I want to look at this. It's amazed in themselves beyond measure and wondered, for they considered not the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. They were dulled down. Okay. They considered not. So we're looking all the way back to what's happened before they started rowing. They considered not. They did not see. That's what it says. They weren't aware of. They didn't catch. They missed it. The miracle. How many times have we missed the miracle? They didn't see it. It just went right by me. I didn't see that coming. I didn't see it coming. I didn't see it happening. I didn't see it going. I missed the whole thing. The miracle. The miracle of what? The miracle, it says, of the loaves. The miracle of depositing the truth. The miracle of the bread of life. They missed the miracle of the loaves. They missed the miracle of the showbread. They missed the miracle of meeting God face to face. I keep coming back to this idea that miracles are tied to relationship with Jesus Christ. And I'm not going to stop because it's true. But I am going to cough. Okay. Now, they considered not the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. Their heart. You know, a few years ago, we spent 52 weeks talking about the heart. But the heart here is the idea of your thinking or your emotion. They didn't catch the miracle of the loaves because their thinking and their emotions didn't pick up on it. The emotional experience wasn't what they were looking for. It was contrary to how they thought it should be. They were all ready to send him away. They just totally didn't get it. And why is he being so hard about this whole thing anyway? And their heart, their thinking, their emotion was hardened. And the word hardened here can mean callous. You know, we can get used to seeing things happen. We get callous about it. But it also means to render stupid. And I think I like that one. Their thinking and emotions were rendered stupid. And so they missed the miracle. And boy, I got to tell you, our society has been rendered stupid. Unfortunately, our churches in many instances have been rendered stupid. We have existence that we can turn to with our very issues in life, whatever they may be. And we're worrying about all kinds of stuff. Like, will we send them away? And do you want me to spend 200 penny worth on bread or what? And we miss the entire miracle because we've been rendered stupid. It says in verse 53, and when they had passed over, they came into the land of Gennesaret and drew to the shore. And then when they were come out of the ship, straightway they knew him. In other words, the crowd was back, a different crowd maybe. And ran through that whole region round about and began to carry about in beds those that were sick, where they heard he was. And whithersoever he entered into villages or cities or country, they laid the sick in the streets and besought him that they might touch, if it were but the border of his garment. And as many as touched him were made whole. See, the disciples, the ones who were close to him, the ones that were there with him, they were unable to see the miracle of the loaves. They were frightened by him walking on the water. They were irritated by the fact that he said they should give. They were probably upset by the fact that he said, go and see what you've got. But he wanted to do miracles because he had compassion for the people. And here, when they get to the other side, the people recognize that he is existence. They recognize that he is the source for what they need, and they bring the sick to him. They let's bring the sick to him. No, let's lock them up for a couple of weeks and keep them safe over there. No, they brought the sick to him. I read something the other day on the internet, made me chuckle, but it says that they laid him on the street there and said, laid him on the streets and beside him that they might touch, if it were just the border or the hem of his garment. And I saw a thing the other day on the internet said, when you feel like your life is hanging by a thread, make sure the thread is from the hem of his garment. And that's really it. They knew where their faith was. They didn't have the same intimacy with him that the disciples had, but they knew that he was the source for what they needed. They knew that he had the answer for them. And see, that goes all the way back to when he said, go and see. He's telling the disciples, go check and see what you've got, but be looking for the miracle. Be looking for the remarkable. Go take an inventory of what you have. Did he need them to go count 5 loaves of bread and 2 fishes? No. He needed them to take a look at what they had faith for. Did they have faith to feed 5,000? No, they had 5 loaves and 2 fishes. You want to see miracles happen, you need to stop counting loaves and fishes and start seeing what you have. You need to take an assessment of what you have. You need to have the ability to say, you know what, we need to bring the sick to be healed, because that's what's going to happen. We need to lay them out, you know, on the street if necessary, just so they can get exposed to God's presence where he can come by. I'm having problems. I just don't know what to do. I've kind of got to shut down. No, you're having problems. You need to go to the master. You need to go to the one that has everything. You need to stop being rendered stupid by life, by the enemy, by your doubts and your fears. And you need to come to him. You need to take that time in prayer. Let him charge you up and get you to the place where you can take an assessment and see, what do I have to give? What's in my heart that I can give out of? If you don't spend time recharging, if you don't spend time in prayer, how can you give out? How can you even go and see? You're blinded by what's going on. We need to spend some time in the tabernacle at the table of showbread, meeting God face to face, letting him charge us up and feed us to keep us going. Recognize that he gave it all so that we could have it all. He is the broken bread that fills us to abundance. And when we start getting our perspective right, then we can go and see what we have to offer those that are in need, and let God's presence pour out of us the truth, deposit into their lives, that will fill them to abundance. And that's what I want today. I want us to be able to let God fill us to abundance. I know this is running a little bit longer than our normal Sunday school of late, but I want to just take a minute and pray. And so, Father, right now, I ask you, first of all, God, that wherever people are watching this, that you would just sweep in to their car, their house, their cubicle at work, wherever they might be, God. That your presence would just sweep in and surround them, God. That your presence would abide with them. God, that you would take the truth of your word and you would deposit it into their lives. And Father, we want to just create that atmosphere for miracles. The first miracle is the relationship with you, that allowing you to be Lord of our lives and giving you our sin and accepting you as our Savior. But God, I ask that you would begin to touch people that are sick today. Father, that you would touch them right where they're at. You know what they need. Father, if it's cancer, you know how to deal with cancer. It can prepare to die because you're going to defeat cancer just like David defeated Goliath. God, if they're dealing with COVID, you can arrest that virus. You can restore normal breathing. You can restore what the virus has tried to take away. You can strengthen them and bring them back to wholeness, Lord God. Father, those that are dealing with fear, I just ask that you would give them your peace. Father, let your peace sweep in like a mighty army and just drive fear out, that we can trust in you. God, if they're struggling in finances or work, that you would take care of those needs, Father. God, I ask you for the pastors of our church, Pastor Steve and Kathy and Pastor Chris and Teresa, God, that you would bless their families, their homes, you'd strengthen them, encourage them, Lord God. Bless them with health, strength, wisdom, and your guiding. Father, for the leadership of the church, God, that you would direct the leadership in the way you want this church to go. Father, for the altar team, that you would just cause them to really lock on to creating that atmosphere for miracles, Father. That all of us would entertain your presence, that we would see those miracles. God, for those that attend the church and watch these videos, Father, that you would touch them right where they are today and meet their needs right where they are today. And Father, we thank you for what you're doing. We thank you for this opportunity to share and hopefully deposit some truth into our hearts and minds. We give you all the praise and all the glory. Amen. And that is our lesson for today. Thank you very much.